This is lesson 2.3, solving problems using rates of change. So the last two lessons have been on average rate of change and instantaneous rate of change. And as we saw in lesson 2.2, we actually determine the instantaneous rate of change by finding the slope of a really, really small secant close to the point in question. So if we are trying to find the slope of the tangent at a certain point, P, we just pick two points very close to P on either side. We can call them Q1 and Q2. And we simply find the slope of their secant. And the slope of that secant is going to be very close to the slope of the tangent. And in fact, the closer Q1 and Q2, the closer that these points move towards P, the better approximation the secant is going to be, right? So if Q1 and Q2 were right here and here, then that secant line is going to be even a closer approximation to the slope of the tangent. So that's what we did last unit. We're going to look at how to solve some problems using rates of change. So let's look at the first example here. A flask, beaker, and graduated cylinder are being filled with water. The rate at which the water flows from the tap is the same when filling all three containers. Draw possible water level versus time graphs for the three containers. So for the flask, beaker, and graduated cylinder, we are going to draw water level versus time graphs. Time on the x-axis, and we'll call it water level on the y-axis. Okay, so this is just to get you thinking about what the graph might look like for each type. So this is the flask, this is the beaker, and this is the graduated cylinder. So if you look at the flask, you can see that if water was pouring in here at a constant rate, the height, if you can imagine this, the height of the water level would actually grow slow at the beginning and then would start to get faster and faster and faster. And then when it got to this little cylinder piece at the top, it's going to be increasing at a constant rate. So you're actually going to see some exponential growth in the height or the water level, and then once it gets to a certain point, you're going to see it just rise at a constant rate. Whereas the beaker, if water is pouring into the beaker, it is just a fixed width the whole way, and so the height of the water level, is just going to rise at a constant rate. And in fact, I'm just going to erase this, and I'm going to make it a little bit less steep, because the width of this is larger than the width of the top of the flask. So the height of the water is going to grow a little bit slower than at this point here. Now the graduated cylinder is thin. The diameter is not as large as the beaker, and so the faster, but at a constant rate because it is the same width the whole way. Okay, number two. Adam and his friend are testing a motion sensor. Adam stands a half a meter in front of the sensor and then walks 4 meters away from it at a constant rate for 10 seconds. Next, Adam walks 1 meter toward the sensor for 5 seconds, then waits there for another 5 seconds. Draw a displacement versus time graph for Adam's motion sensor walk. Okay, so we are going to put time along the bottom, the x-axis, and this is going to be in seconds. And along the y-axis, we're going to put Adam's distance, actually, displacement. The difference being, distance is the total distance from a starting point. So if Adam walks away from the sensor and then walks towards the sensor, there's still a total distance that he has been traveling. Pretend Adam's wearing one of those step meters and it counts the number of steps. The total distance would be the total number of steps he's taking, whereas the displacement is the distance from the origin, from the starting point. Okay, so Adam stands half a meter in front of the sensor. So at the very beginning, Adam is half a meter. This is in meters. So right at the beginning, Adam is here at half a meter, and then walks 4 meters away from it at a constant rate of 10 seconds. So I am going to mark this 5 seconds, 10, 15, 20, 25. Okay. So for a total of 10 seconds, Adam is walking away from the motion sensor, 4 meters away. So if he starts a half meter away and he walks 4 meters away, he's going to be at 4.5 after 10 seconds. So we're going to see a line like this, and this coordinate is 10, 4.5. And this coordinate, obviously, down here is 0.5. Okay, then Adam walks 1 meter toward the sensor. So he's walking back towards the sensor 1 meter for 5 seconds. So from 10 to 15 seconds, he's walking 1 meter back. So that's going to be 3.5. So that point is 15, 3.5. So at the 15 second point, Adam should be 3.5 meters away from the sensor. And then it says he waits there for another 5 seconds. So just he doesn't move. Just for 5 seconds, he's staying at the same position. So this is just going to be a horizontal line. There's no change in the displacement. And this point is 20, 3.5. And that's it. Part B, what is the average rate of change in his distance in the first 10 seconds? So the average rate of change from 0 to 10 seconds is simply going to be D at 10 minus D at 0 over 10 minus 0. So it's just rise over run. And if we look at our graph, D of 10 is 4.5. That's the Y value. And D of 0, the Y value at 0, or I should say the displacement value, is 0.5. Okay, and then 10 minus 0 is 10. And so we end up with 4 over 10, which is equal to 0.4 meters per second. So the average rate of change in his distance in the first 10 seconds is 0.4 meters per second. So on average, he's moving away from the sensor at 0.4 meters per second. Okay, now part C, what are the instantaneous rates of change at t equals 1 and t equals 7? So at exactly 1 second, if we look at our graph, at 1 second, which is around here, we want to find the slope of the tangent, and the slope of the tangent is actually the same thing as the slope of this line. So really we just have to find the slope of this line, and we just did that in part A. In part A, we actually found the slope of that line. And so we can quickly answer this as 0.4 meters per second, same as in part A. Now at 7 seconds, 7 being around here, that is also going to be on this line. And so the slope of the tangent is the same as the slope of that line. So that is also 0.4 meters per second. No need to show any work there. Okay, part D, what was the average rate of change in the next 5 seconds? So basically we're talking from 10 to 15 seconds. So that's going to be D at 15 minus D at 10 over 15 minus 10. So you go to your graph, and at 15 seconds, the displacement was 3.5. And if you remember, at 10 seconds, it was 4.5. And we're dividing by 15 minus 10. So this is negative 1 over 5. Oops, negative 1 over 5, which is negative 0.2 meters per second. So between 10 and 15 seconds, Adam is moving at an average rate of negative 0.2 meters per second. So that actually means he's moving towards the motion sensor at an average of 0.2 meters per second. Okay, part E, what were the instantaneous rates of change at t equals 12 and t equals 14? I'm gonna let you solve that one. And part F, what was the instantaneous rate of change at 18 seconds? So if we go up to our graph and we look at 18, which is somewhere around here, the slope of the tangent at that point is actually just a horizontal line. The slope of that is 0. So the instantaneous rate of change at precisely 18 seconds is 0 meters per second. Okay, so draw a speed versus time graph for Adam's motion sensor walk. So we're going to put time along the X, and we're going to put speed along the y-axis. This is going to be meters per second, and this will be in seconds. Okay, so we need to go up to 20 seconds for the length of the experiment. And we saw in our work above that from 0 to 10, the average rate of change was 0.4 meters per second. So that was the average speed, because the rate of change of displacement over time is really just the speed. So if we make that 0.2, 0.1, 0.3, 0.4, we can say that Adam's speed from 0 to 10 was a constant speed of 0.4. Now, from 10 to 15, we saw that the answer was negative 0.2 meters per second. However, we are just calculating speed here, and so we don't really need to include the direction. So from 10 to 15, the speed was 0.2. The velocity was negative 0.2, but Adam's speed is the magnitude, which is simply just 0.2. So we can ignore this sign when we're talking about the speed. In other words, we don't really care which way he's moving, towards or away from the motion sensor. We just know that he's traveling at 0.2 meters per second. And then from 15 to 20, he's not moving. He's just staying still. So that is a speed of 0. Okay, so we've run out of time. We're going to do these two in class. We'll do some more practice questions as well and get you ready for the test that is coming up soon. Okay, bye for now.